Coming up, a hot new phone only available in China. Jason Howell has it. We'll review a mechanical keyboard with a nice clicky sound, a wearable camera, and the latest tablet from Toshiba. It's time to watch before you buy.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Before You Buy is brought to you by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com. Before You Buy is brought to you by BarkBox, a monthly box of high quality, fun, and healthy goodies for your dog delivered right to your door. Save 20% when you sign up for a new subscription. Visit BarkBox.com/TWiT and use the code TWIT at checkout.
Ho! Hello, everybody. Welcome to Before You Buy, the product review show where we get real live TWiT staffers to use products and give you their opinion, what it would be like to actually own this product. We got an email from a viewer not so long ago, a couple of weeks ago, saying, hey, I have a Xiaomi Mi 4. This is a phone, a smartphone that's available only in China. Xiaomi got a lot of attention when Google's Hugo Barra left Google to go run Xiaomi. And many think it's a really up-and-coming phone company, but you can't get their phones yet in the U.S. We thought we'd get it for Jason Howell, so he host of All About Android, so he could review it. And I think he likes it. There's the Mi 4.
I mean, we just got this yesterday. By the way, that gentleman is Pete Lambros. He's the one that reached out to us and gave us the invite. I guess when he bought one through an importer, they ended up charging him and sending him two of them.
Oh.
He was like, well, I can either return it for a fee, or if you want it, I already have it, so I'll sell it to you for what I paid for
it. How much was it?
$480.
Okay,
right around
so
there.
It's less expensive than a traditional feature.
Yes, exactly. Although if you're in China, buying this unlocked is $320 equivalent.
Okay.
So it's a pretty low-cost device.
It may be called the Mi 2. It looks very similar to an iPhone.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I've only had it, like I said, for about 24 hours now, and I have to say my initial impression is that this is a really awesome device. I'm super impressed with it. It does take a lot of design cues, both on the software and the hardware. At the front of it, it looks a lot like an iPhone.
Or a Samsung a little bit, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And particularly on the back. The back looks kind of like a Samsung mm-hmm. backplate of some type. So it's kind of, sandwiched together between, you know, maybe the things that work for other manufacturers. Xiaomi just seems to be really good at kind of taking some of those features and making it their own. The thing is, like, when you look at a device like this on video, my initial reaction before I had it in hand was, oh, it looks like a knockoff. I bet that's a kind of a cheap device.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah.
But man, when you use this device, I can honestly say I have not used an Android device that's as snappy and responsive as this one is. And it's running Xiaomi's own version of Android, forked version, called MIUI. And it's just, everything feels super fluid. You can see it's different than the normal Android kind of layout. Apps are arranged on, sideways as opposed to in an app drawer, which kind of mimics the way it's done on iOS.
It looks very much like iOS, yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of similarities, but it's really cool. So what I'm doing today, obviously I've only had it for 24 hours, so I'm going to be playing with it for the next week, and I'll do a full review next week. But I think what's interesting here is kind of what makes this important, right? You said that it's, Xiaomi is a Chinese manufacturer, Chinese company. You can't really get this device in the States unless you go through some sort of an importer, which is
which you can do. I mean, people
which you
do
can
that.
Do.
We
and
have
you
one.
Can go online and you could find it right now for around $470, $480, and that's unlocked and still. How this device, this hardware, compares to the top-of-the-line devices like the Galaxy S5 right now. I mean, in my time with this, I would choose this over the S5, and it's still less expensive. At $480, it's still a great deal.
It's a beautiful screen.
The screen is
I think
phenomenal.
You can even tell in the video that it's very solid and crisp.
It's a 5-inch screen, 1920 by 1080p IPS LCD at 441 pixels per inch. Mm. So, I mean, the resolution is just out of this world, and it's super sharp and vibrant. It's just really an impressive thing to see.
But not unique. I mean, the same as the HTC One or the Galaxy
PS5.
Sure. But yeah, I mean, you know, I guess ultimately when you get to that kind of high pixels per inch,
right.
Yeah, you hope for that. And I'm always wanting to have a reason to turn on this display because it's so beautiful.
It is quad core, but it's a 800, not an 801.
No, it's an 801.
Oh, it is an 801.
It is 2.5 gigahertz quad core Snapdragon 801 with 3 gigs of RAM. So, I mean, it's screaming. When I'm playing games on here, it has a couple of different modes versus like, you know, kind of a battery efficient mode versus full power. And it has a 3,080 milliamp hour battery.
Oh, that's big.
And the battery so far has been really great. I turned it on full power, and today I've been running on that. And I mean, you can hardly see any dent in my battery. Of course, I've been here where there's plenty of Wi-Fi and everything. This particular model only runs on, like, I'm on LTE, and I have my SIM in there. But it's a 3G phone here in the States. The only place you're going to get LTE is in China.
The
on
frequencies
their,
are wrong.
Yeah, LTE TBA in China. They are coming out with a version of this later this year, I'm aware of, that will be compatible with other LTE.
We were a little concerned that you would be in Chinese, but apparently you can have it.
You set that in and set up. Okay. Yeah, it gives you, you know, it defaults to Chinese. The very first screen you see when you factory reset is select your language.
Right.
And everything kind of falls in line. But yeah, you know, it's a really interesting device. In China, Xiaomi is the number one OEM. Their phones are priced nearly at cost, narrow profit margin. They're looking to make money off the ecosystem. Things like themes. You can go into their theme store and you can use Mi points that you purchase, kind of like Xbox points, right? Where you purchase points and then you can, you know, find all these different themes and apply them and everything.
So they're not a carrier, they're a manufacturer.
Manufacturer, exactly.
Okay. Are they on China Telecom, all the Chinese carriers?
Yeah, they're predominantly.
This is the phone.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Their devices are sold for 18 months. That's to maximize profit, and available through their site, they do flash sales. So for example, today, the Mi 3, which is the one before this one, had a flash sale of 20,000 devices to India, sold out in less than 3 seconds.
What?
It took three seconds for 20,000 people to add it to their cart, basically, is what that means.
Now, the MIUI.
So people go crazy for these devices.
The MIUI operating system is based on Android. You said no Google services.
No Google services. However, if you go to the Mi Market, there is an app that allows you to install the Play Store.
Oh.
And it does get updated from Google once it's installed, so it passes that security kind of checkpoint on Google's part.
And then you can get any Play Store.
Yeah, so
app.
I've created a folder here with all of my Google apps, and they're all in there, and they're updating through the Play Store and everything. So. So yeah, that was one of the first things that I did. So it's an interesting device, and I'm really looking forward to, you know, to playing with it. The build quality is just top-notch, super snappy, the screen's incredible. So far, I'm really digging it.
It's an interesting mix, which we don't see much in the U.S., of metal and plastic. Yeah. Metal in the, it is a metal case.
Stainless steel.
But
chassis.
That's kind of beautiful.
Yep.
But then it's got a plastic back, which I think
does, but it's not a hollow plastic back. You know, like, what I'm realizing now is not all plastic is created equal, right?
Yes.
There's some plastic phones that feel like a toy. And then there's some plastic, you know, even the OnePlus One, that's a plastic backing, but it feels premium. It's just a different type of plastic they've done right. And this, done right. I think it feels really great.
What do we know of their plans to sell in the U.S.?
Well, that's the tricky part, right? There is so much here that if this was sold in the U.S., there's lawsuit written all over it. So I think Xiaomi has a lot to overcome if they plan on entering the U.S. market. And part of the reason that they hired Hugo Barra from Google is because, you know, he is now the VP of International at Xiaomi, and he's made no bones about the fact that their plan is to open it up. So maybe we'll see it someday, but they're gonna have to tread lightly as far as their design points are concerned, because I mean, down to these little details where it's kind of shaved on the side, it's kind of hard to see on video here, but it looks so much like the iPhone that it's just kind of uncanny. Ron Amadio of Ars Technica also did a review. He's going to be on tonight's All About Android.
We're going to
be talking about this.
Oh, good.
And he made just a really good point, which is that Xiaomi, as you know, as a creator of hardware, yes, their designs are very derivative, but that doesn't make them bad. You know what I mean?
Right.
They do it really well.
Right.
They have derivative design that's executed really, really well.
And you could argue everybody's deriving something from everybody else at this point. There's no completely original phone. You wouldn't want it.
Yeah.
Oh, great, a phone shaped like a circle.
I don't know. We may see that someday if people freak out as much as they do about the Moto 360.
All right, thank you, Jason Howell. Yeah. We'll see more tonight on All About Android.
Yes.
And next week, a full review of the Xiaomi Mi 4.
That's right.
Yeah, we know you can't get it in the U.S., but we're, first of all, we are seen all over the world, even in China. And yes, second of all, you can.
Yeah.
You just
have to go through
LTE,
a few hoops to do it.
And that's something important to consider, LTE. Thank you, Jason.
You bet.
Now we go to Chad Johnson. He's getting funky.
Funky.
Chad is the host of OMG Craft and Reddit Up.
And Gizwiz.
And Gizwiz. And he has the Funk KB460 mechanical keyboard.
Yeah, so this keyboard is one in a long line of keyboards that has fully mechanical keys. These are really, really desired when you're gaming or you do a lot of typing. Let me make sure I'm not going to type on anything that I don't want to type on.
Oh, so it's hooked up to your laptop.
It's hooked up my laptop because I wanted to show off the backlit keys. So you can see that these are backlit.
Ooh, and a nice pretty red backlighting.
Yeah, and also back behind that backlighting, there is some red behind each individual key, which is kind of nice. That the board back there is also backlit. These are Cherry MX red switches, so they give a nice tactile click when you start to type.
Ah, it sounds nice.
Yeah, it feels really nice. It sounds nice. Obviously, if you're in a studio like us, or you record video games for YouTube like I do, this is going to be too loud to do something like that. But hopefully, this won't annoy your neighbors if you're in an office. Too much.
But if you're writing a book at home,
writing
you don't
a book
mind
at
the
home,
noise. That's
or
really
you're programming.
That's right. The way to go.
Absolutely. They feel really great. Every single key is mechanical, including the function keys, the home, delete, insert, end keys, and the numpad. All of the keys are mechanical. Sometimes keyboards will skimp on some of the less used keys. Backlight has, for me, I found that it had four different variations: full bright, sort of a medium, low bright, and then an off. They say that it has seven. Maybe I have a different version. But anyway, four different variations of user selectable backlighting. There's a few functions as well. There is the funk function, which basically turns off your Windows and Alt Tab keys so that you're not actually gonna lose it.
Nice
your
for
game.
Gamers. Nice
yeah,
for gamers.
This is funk mode, so you hit down function and then you turn on funk mode, and you can tell based over here on the side that funk mode.
Funk's on. We've been funky.
Funk has been enabled, and then that'll turn off when you turn that off. Comes with a braided cord on the back, which is pretty nice. It's just kind of a nice accent, kind of a pro.
I like that.
Mm-hmm. I
Plus,
do
they
too.
Don't tangle that way.
Yeah. They don't tangle nearly as much. Now, it does come with a palm rest, and that's what on the front of this, there are these little things. They give you not only the palm rest, but little connectors to connect it to the bottom of your keyboard. This, I gotta say, was pretty crappy. The palm rest is just a piece of plastic that they've molded and added the sort of non-slick surface onto. But I found that whenever I would move the keyboard around, this palm rest it would rest against your palms, but anytime you try to move the keyboard, it flops around. It would easily become detached if I was trying to, say, move something to get to the back ports or something like that. I found the palm rest to be really just an annoyance more than something that I look forward to using. On the back, there are two USB pass-throughs, which is really great because on the other end of this, there's only one USB cord. Lots of times when there's a USB pass-through on the other end of the cord, there'll be two or three USB ports to make sure that that's a perfect pass-through. This is not only it's working as USB hub instead of a pure pass-through, which I really, really liked, instead of needing to wire in and using up a second USB port. Now, this is a gaming keyboard, so they offer software and gaming features with that software, like adding your macro keys. You can do up to 10 macro keys per profile. You have 5 profiles, so that's essentially 50 different macro keys. Their software is okay. It's not the best. There's a lot of competition and So there's some really good software when it comes to keyboard management. And this one's in the okay to fine category. It's not great. You have to like hit a key and then assign. Sometimes you can record and then assign and stuff like that. One nice feature is that this does have 128 kilobytes of memory on board on the keyboard, so you can save those macros to the keyboard and then take your keyboard away. You don't need to save that on the computer, and if you switch computers, you've lost all of your customizations. This does have the in-key rollover, which means that you can press basically as many simultaneous keys as you want, and the operating system will see each of those key presses, and so anti-ghosting. That sort of stuff with the in-key rollover. There are media controls on the top for volume, up, down, play, pause, skip, and next, and you activate those with a function key that's in between your Alt and menu key over here. The cord length is 6 feet, so 1.8 meters is the length on the cord, and they also offer varieties of this in US keyboard layout. French, German, Nordic, Russian, and UK layouts are available. So for the pros of this keyboard, I really liked the USB hub instead of just pure pass-throughs. I enjoyed that it was backlit, and I liked the palm, the in-key rollover was another great feature. Now, for the cons, I'm gonna say the palm rest really left something to be desired. You can kind of see over here, what do you call it? Finish is nice, but greasy fingers will leave greasy stains on this type of, it's a little hard to see, but sort of greasy palms will create greasy smudges on the keyboard. The cost is $122.79 currently on Amazon. Retail MSRP is $139.95, something like that. But
looks like
I could
a nice
find
keyboard.
It. Yeah, I could find it on Amazon for $122. Yeah. Buy, try, don't buy for the Funk KB460. I'm going to give this one a buy. No reason you shouldn't buy it. I didn't find anything wrong with it, and I was really impressed. And I love those Cherry MX Red switches.
It is a little expensive.
It's very expensive.
Yeah.
This
but you
category,
get a lot of features for that.
Yeah, this product carries a lot like the upper echelon, kind of higher tier Bluetooth speakers that they're always in the above $100 range.
Yeah. Now, I want to talk a little bit about Cherry MX. We've gone on and on about a keyboard, but as long as we're talking. So Cherry MX is a physical mechanical switch.
Yes.
And sometimes people liken it to the old IBM keyboards, but they use a different technology called a buckling key, which is a little funkier than Cherry MX. Also, Cherry offers different feels. Can you get all the different feels on that?
For this one, this
which one is that?
Specifically red, the red switches.
The red.
And
those are the clicky ones?
Yeah, these are clicky. So they'll do an audible sound. I'm going to pull the keyboard up to my mic so you can hear that they will click.
Hear that click?
Yeah. That's a click that's built into the switch. Yeah. They offer brown switches, which are silent. They don't add that click. Now, you're still going to get a keyboard press sound, but you're not going to get that physical click.
People like the feel of these switches because they're so tactile, and some say it makes you more accurate typer. It's better for your wrists, things like that.
And the different colors are the different models.
Kinds. And black, red, blue.
And so this one is 45 grams of what they call actuation force, which is the force to press the key down.
Do you like that? I mean, I admit it's noisy, but do you like that?
This
feel?
Is my favorite switch.
Yeah,
the
for
red,
gaming. Yeah.
Because it's a light press. It's not a moderate or hard press to get the key to push down. Some of them are too light. This one I find is my favorite. It just feels natural. The red ones are my favorite. Browns are good, but because they're a lot quieter. We actually have another brown in the studio that we're reviewing.
Really?
Yeah, we do. We happen to have the keyboard. These are pro products for gamers, and so that's why I can say, $120 is kind of normal. They're definitely making a good margin off of it, so there's a lot of competition in this space for mechanical keyboards nowadays.
I have to get a buckling spring keyboard, and we'll compare. We'll have a little click-off.
I just realized that there's this whole world there's of knowledge world. Around keyboards that I had no idea about until just now.
Yeah. And the in-key rollover is another really big thing because some keyboards will not tell the operating system if you've pressed more than, say, five
right.
keys.
They'll just...
It'll just stop. So if you're trying to do some crazy maneuver, where not only are you hitting, you know, WA to move forward and strife left, but you're hitting, you know, four to get your gun out, and then you're also doing something else on the keyboard, like you hit a macro that's pressing five keys at once. All of that is really, really needed in a gaming keyboard.
Right.
So
it's a serious topic, Jason. Please.
It is.
I know. Apparently, it is.
Yeah.
I've been taking pictures of you the whole time.
Oh, what?
With this VView squared wearable camera. We're going to get a review from Brian in just a second. But first, it's time for Ozzy to give us a review of our newest sponsor, BarkBox. How about doggy treats delivered every month to your door through BarkBox? Don't you love it? Not just treats that you can eat, although Ozzy really loves these chicken breast jerky treats. There's different ones every month, but they also include toys. We've got a little toy here, a lobster toy. And then I love this. This was just this month's box, but this is for wiping his feet off when he comes indoors or giving a little towel off. You get to choose the size of your dog. He's the extra small, under 10 pounds.
I would guess.
He's just waiting. He knows we're doing the BarkBox ad, and he's just been waiting. This is kind of good. This is a lobster roll with parsley for fresh
Look
breath.
Look at how nice he's being.
He just says, you know, it would be nice if you would give me a taste of my BarkBox. He really loves his BarkBox. Isn't this cute?
Yeah.
I want you to visit BarkBox.com/twit. Oh. You know what?
Oh, God.
That's good.
Don't.
What? No, it's delicious.
It's food.
It's food. This is the chicken breast jerky. Ozzy, would you like some? Yes, you're a good doggy. Oh, he loves his BarkBox. You will... No, it's not bad. It's kind of tasty. Want some?
Go ahead, Chad. Try it.
No, thank you.
Chad would totally love to have some.
BarkBox.com/twit. Now I have parsley breath. Nom, 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 nom. We believe, says BarkBox, dogs deserve real food. And what's great about this is... All the treats are sourced from the U.S. and Canada only, nowhere else. So, you know, these are high-quality treats. The chews are made in the U.S., Canada, South America, Australia, and New Zealand. There is no rawhide or anything processed with formaldehyde. If you care about your puppy, you know about these things. And we have a special deal for you. You're going to get 20% off your new subscription when, when you use the offer code TWIT at BarkBox. Choose for the... By the way, you can get it... For just 1 month, if you're not sure, or if you know, like Ozzy, your dog will love BarkBox. You can get a year. That saves you some money. Every month, more treats. Right, Ozzy? He loves his... Oh, do you see him lick his lips?
He smells your breath.
He loves the BarkBox, don't you, Ozzy? BarkBox.com/twit. You want to play with Mr. Lobster?
Oh,
he said, I'd rather have a chicken treat.
Seriously?
Go get
Mr.
it. Go
Lobster?
Get it.
Seriously?
Seriously? Yeah.
You're kidding.
You gave me BarkBox, and now it's Mr. Lobster.
When there's
what
turkey jerky on the line, I'm going to go after a lobster.
Oh, yeah.
That's it. Get brave. Get brave, Ozzy. Go there.
All right. BarkBox.com/twit. Save 20% on your new subscription right now. Yeah, I love this sponsor, and he is very happy.
Ozzy seems to be enjoying it.
Ozzy tested. Ozzy approved. All right, let's find out about this camera, the VView. We give all cameras now to Brian Burnett. He's just a camera hog. And our technical director here, we asked him, what do you think of wearing a camera around all day, Brian?
Brian Burnett from Before You Buy and Twit, here to show you the VView Squared. It's a small wearable action cam touted as a tough, versatile camera made by cops for cops. And when taking a close look at the VView, it does feel like it could take a bullet. With its anodized aluminum housing, the VView has some heft to it, but feels very high quality. It weighs in at 2.4 ounces with a compact footprint of just 2 by 2 inches, and it is water resistant. So you can get it wet, but don't drop it into your pool. On the front is a grippy rubberized door that slides down to reveal a tiny camera capable of recording at 1080, 720, or even at 640 by 360. There is one button on the side, and it is used for turning the Vivu on and off. And when you want to start recording, all you have to do is slide the door down, and boom, you're recording. A small flap folds down for the micro USB for charging and transferring files, and next to that is an LED letting you know when the Vivu is fully charged. Inside the Vivu is a 16GB non-removable storage, and it does have built-in Wi-Fi. So that means you can record up to 5 hours at 1080p, and during my review I never ran out of battery. If you wanted to do continuous streaming to a device, such as your smartphone, you could expect around 2 hours of recording at 1080. To connect the Vivu, you'll need to download their app. Linking up with my Moto X was a breeze thanks to the easy-to-use software. The Vivu sets up the Wi-Fi signal, which connects through the app, and you can start using your phone as a viewfinder right away. I've tested out a lot of action cameras that use this similar kind of feature, and the Vivu has some really low latency and looks really good on the phone. Also, this is where you can access the capture settings and even download the video files directly to your phone. As for mounting hardware, there aren't a lot of options. For this review, I was limited to a belt buckle tab, so I had to get a little creative. I first attached it to the GoPro chest mount I had, which worked okay, but the angle was pointed down a lot, so it wasn't that great. Then I taped it to the front of my helmet, and that didn't really work out that well either. But it did work well when I clipped it to the collar of my shirt. So if you've ever wondered what it's like to be Brian Burnett and walk into Twit, TD iPad today, and then edit it later, well, this is the perspective. For the pros, the fit and finish on the Vivu is top notch. The all aluminum housing feels really solid, and the door on the front of the camera has an audible click letting you know that you slid it into the filming position. Next is just how simple it is to use. Slide down the door to start recording, and the LED blinks red on the top of the camera, and just shut the door when you want to stop recording. The software has no fluff and is just an easy to understand user interface, and it just works. As for cons, it is a bit pricey, coming in at $349.99. That's just $50 less than the top of the line GoPro. The camera quality is disappointing in low light and grainy slash hazy in the broad daylight. It's good enough for its size, but don't expect GoPro-esque video. The last con is mounting. You only get the clip type mount, and that means unless you want lots of butt shots from your belt or wear some sort of shirt that has a place to clip it to, finding locations to give you a good view are hard to find. So is the Vivu Squared a buy, try, or don't buy? I'm going to go with a buy. The price is a bit steep, but if you're looking for a very discreet, well-built cam, the Vivu Squared offers a rugged camera that's small enough to carry around in your pocket when you need it. Also, sliding the door to record meant I could instantly know if I was recording footage or not without having to actually look at the camera. In the end, the Vivu Squared doesn't match well against GoPros as purely an action cam due to the video quality, but if you're looking for a little less action and something tough and portable, the Vivu Squared could be the compact cam for you. This has been Brian Burnett from Before You Buy. Thanks for watching.
So a buy on the Vivu from Brian Burnett. Brian is our technical director, runs this show, and technical director for a lot of shows on the Twit Network. Now we've got our new director in-house. Mr. Mike right. Elgin is here.
Took a break from directing news.
You there.
Yeah.
Story, go there. He's also the host of TNT Monday through yep. Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern Time, 1700 UTC, your daily dose of tech news. We gave you a tablet.
Yes.
You like the iPad. In fact, I remember when you've been on Twit,
yeah.
in the past anyway, that
right.
you've used a tablet, an iPad with a keyboard. Do you still do that?
I do, and I love the iPad. I'm a huge fan. I've owned probably 4 or 5 of them now, I think. And I just, it's the best tablet there is.
So this is Android.
Yeah, this is Windows. This is full
Windows. Oh, it does Windows. Look a little like yeah. Windows. Is it RT or is it Windows
it's
Pro?
It's the full Windows,
wow.
including legacy support for legacy apps.
Oh.
And this is a surprising device. Now, just let's start with the basics. It's $199.99. This is $200 tablet
bucks.
For full Windows. If you look at the back, this looks really, really nice.
I paid more than that for the Windows yes. 8 disc.
Yes, exactly.
Holy cow.
Yeah, but this is so nice that this could almost be a Xiaomi. That's how nice it is. But it's a really nice tablet. It was launched a couple of months ago. It weighs less than a pound. It does have, you know, it is a Windows device. So my first out of the box experience was I had to spend a half an hour updating 33 updates.
Well, but
so
that's
it's not
Windows,
it's
yeah.
not exactly an yeah. iPad. Runs an a quad core Intel Atom Z3740 processor that has integrative graphics. So that's one of the corners they cut in order to make it so inexpensive. So the graphics are not super great, but they're good enough. And it has only 1 gig of RAM. So
Ooh,
that's on the low side for a full Windows device. Although you really don't see it using it too much for the most part. In fact, most of the little glitches here and there that do pop up are in the graphics side, not in the core processing, and so or in the RAM or anything like that. So it seems to be they're getting away with it, I guess is what I'm saying. This is a 1280 by 800 LED backlit screen. Gets about 8 to 10 hours of battery life, depending on whether you're watching video or doing anything like that. That's, you know, I can get a little bit more than 10. So they're sort of sandbagging it there. Comes in 32 or 64 gigabytes of onboard storage. Windows gobbles up a huge amount of that. So you're not going to get anywhere. If you get the 32 gig one, you're not going to get anywhere near that. And 2.0 megapixel camera, front-facing 8.0 megapixel, auto-focusing in the rear camera, and it's an okay camera. Everything about this tablet, I think this is a really interesting tablet, and the reason is that whenever you get into these super low-cost tablets, there's almost always something that really bugs you. Like, it's a deal killer. This doesn't have one. A deal killer. It looks nice. It performs well. It's got a really nice screen, but not spectacular. And again, that price is absolutely killer. It comes with a full version of Windows 8.1, as I said.
Not Office, though, for that price.
It comes with a free subscription to Office 365 Personal, which is a $70 value.
All right.
For 1 year. And then you have to pay for it. It has a really interesting set of utilities. It has this Toshiba product called True Capture, and this is designed for capturing pictures of books and whiteboards and things like that. It's for capturing content, not, you know, art photography.
That makes sense, though. That's kind of one of the use cases for something like this.
Yes.
You take it to a meeting,
yep.
Take a picture of the whiteboard at the end.
Exactly.
Take some notes. No stylus, though.
Yeah. It does not have a stylus, which is different from the Asus VivoTab Note 8, which is a very similar and comparable device to this. And, of course, it's got, you know, little bits and pieces of Toshiba help support software, you know, that kind of thing, which you always get with these devices.
Does it have a desktop? It is Windows 8, so it must have a desktop mode.
I don't think it does because it's a tablet, right?
Surface has a desktop.
If you go into the settings, you immediately get into the hardcore Windows type stuff. But this is a really, really nice tablet. I like this a lot. And it also has a lot more sensors than some of the other tablets in this category. For example, it has, you know, an ambient light sensor, gyroscope, an accelerometer, GPS, digital compass, and vibration for haptic feedback. So they're really not cutting corners on sensors. And I really liked it. And I'm actually
$200. That just blows me away.
The main competitors, if you compare this with the iPad Mini with Retina, okay, the iPad Mini with Retina is a better tablet. It's significantly better. The App Store is much better. The screen is much better. And if you need the App Store stuff, but if you just want a tablet that's running Windows, that runs your Windows applications, this is really a great one. It's, like I said, it's comparable to the VivoTab Note 8. And that costs about $50 more. Now, $50 more doesn't sound like a lot more, but at these prices, that's 25% more. That's a lot more. And so I'm going to give this a buy.
This is the desktop, by
the way.
It's just when you get to the desktop,
it's so small.
I don't know how you'd use it.
Right.
You can press the Windows key also. There's a Windows key. You know, normally there's a physical Windows key on these things. It's up at the top.
Yeah,
wow.
I don't even want to use this on a laptop. I mean, it's I like the so-called Metro UI.
Yeah. Yeah, but you'd probably want to stick with that just because these touch targets you can see. I mean, you can barely, my finger is awfully big compared to that.
Personally, I wouldn't choose a Windows tablet over an Android tablet or an iOS tablet. However, if you need one, you know who you are, right?
Well, so, I could see if you were using, for instance, if there were a Windows app you had to use day in, day out, and it happened to work on an 8-inch screen like this, this might be a really good choice for you.
There are lots of people who need Windows applications. Yeah. And there are some people who just want, who just like this. I mean, let's face it, we've talked about this a lot. This is a great user interface. They were a little late with it, but this is a really compelling user interface. So for a novice or somebody who's used to Windows or whatever, $200 is really, really cheap for what you get in this tablet.
Pros and cons.
Well, the pros include that
I'll play with this while you talk.
It's cheap. It looks good. It's responsive. And the sound is actually good. Now, the sound is interesting. The sound is not good for music, per se. It's okay for music, and it's not loud enough.
Right?
But it's really good for spoken words, for TV and movies and so on. I was watching you earlier live through the live.twit.tv stream, and it sounded fantastic. It's got stereo speakers and Dolby sound. And for something like watching Twitch shows, it's really, really great. The sound is really, really good in that regard. So those are the pros. The cons are there's some minor graphics hiccups. Every once in a while, you get a little glitchiness, which is the kind of thing you'd expect. You'd expect actually a lot more of that from a Windows machine running at this price. It doesn't have a docking station. It doesn't have a stylus. I personally don't like those kinds of things. I'd much rather go with a Bluetooth keyboard, and who needs a mouse? And it's not high res. But
that's pretty good. I'm watching us on the TV, see there. Very interesting.
You turn that up. So you won't be able to tell, really, but listen to that.
Oh, that's very good. That's very good.
Look at that. Listen to that velvety voice.
That's whoever that is.
It's incredible.
He knows what he's doing. Now we're going to get a very weird Inception moment here. But you know what? That's that just proves it's running Flash. That's a real Windows. That's amazing.
Yeah.
So a buy?
A
try.
Buy. This is a buy. I'd definitely give this a buy. At these prices, why not? $200. I mean, this is a really good tablet running full Windows.
I can't believe you can do that in 1 gig of RAM. Yeah. That's what's really my
problem. It is. I don't know how they do it.
No. And of course, there's competitors. You mentioned there's a Dell Venue Pro 8.
Yep.
There's quite a few in this category because Microsoft's giving away Windows to anybody with less than a 9-inch screen.
That's right. That helps the price a lot. But the bottom line is that they of course they cluster on the higher end and the lower end for the 8-inch tablets. This is similar to the higher end ones, and it's got a lower end price.
Great price.
And that's really the killer feature.
Ladies and gentlemen, a buy on the Toshiba Encore Tour. They do, for a little bit more, have a 10-inch version of this.
Yes, they do. And
not as pocketable, though.
That's right. This is same screen resolution, same low memory. That one has the 1 gigabyte as well. So I really prefer this one over the 10-inch. I don't see any reason to have 10-inch. If they had a higher resolution screen or something, yes, but no, they don't have that.
This is what Steven Sinofsky was thinking when he came up with Windows 8. Very interesting. Yeah. All right, thank you, Mike Elgin. Yeah. We'll see you on TNT tomorrow and every morning, Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern time. And that does it for our edition of Before You Buy. If there's stuff you'd like to see us review, you can email byb@twit.tv. We also make all these reviews available individually on our YouTube site, youtube.com/beforeyoubuy. You can subscribe to the show in iTunes or wherever you get your netcasts, including our great third-party Twit apps. There are lots of them. And Stitcher, I know Mike likes Stitcher because TNT is pretty much always the number one show on Stitcher.
It's we love Stitcher. Stitcher loves us.
It's a mutual admiration society. Right. So do please get each and every episode and share it with your friends. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time. Remember, you got to watch before you buy. Bye-bye.